Welcome to episode 13 of the Non-Fun Gerbils podcast. I'm Luke.
And I am George.
And today we are delighted to be joined by Alan Carr of Dapper Labs. Alan is a general legend in the space. He was co-founder of Kittycalc, product lead for Cryptokitties, and is now focused on the design and implementation for NBA Topshot, the NBA's official digital collectibles and game coming out soon on Flow. This was such a fun episode to record. We hope you enjoyed as much as we did. And stay tuned at the end for surprise and delight when we find out who Prepper Gerbil is.
Welcome to the Non-Fun Gerbils podcast, the show about digitally scarce gerbils, non-fungible assets, and the growing decentralized economy.
Alan, thank you very much for joining us. A very warm welcome onto the podcast.
Thank you.
I would like to start by saying thank you for your creative support from day one. You've been sending us gerbil backstories from the beginning and lead the way in terms of how many gerbils you've authored. So thank you very much.
I've been a huge fan of the podcast and of the concept overall. I really love the fact that you've created a non-fungible token podcast supported by a community that's rewarded with non-fungible tokens. It makes so much sense, and I just love it.
Fantastic. So maybe we could start with a little bit about your background and how you got into the space and what you're doing now.
Yeah, so I'm obviously super, super interested in this space and non-fungible tokens, in crypto in general, but it was actually CryptoKitties that brought me into the space. So a little bit of background about myself. So I worked at Blizzard Entertainment for a little while doing stuff on their web team. And after a stint as a game master and then a specialist game master. So if you got hacked in World of Warcraft, I was the guy you came to kind of track down what happened to all of your stuff and return it to you.
Amazing.
And so I have kind of this very inside view of digital goods from that experience. Of course, I'm a gamer. I love playing games. So one game that was really close to my heart was City of Heroes. I really enjoyed that experience of getting to create custom heroes and then later villains and, you know, customize not only their look and you know, you can imagine kind of a different backstory for them, but then also you could customize their superpowers and then go into a game and experience life as that superhero within this MMO. And I actually really got into the character creation part. I never played the game competitively. It actually wasn't the most fun game for me, but creating the characters and getting to experience, like, you know, creating something that was mine, that reflected my personality, and then going and experiencing that game asset, it was something that was awesome for me. Like, at the time it came out, I owned a Mac, and the game didn't run on Mac, so I actually bought the game, and then I would pay hourly to go to a PC cafe to play the game, which was crazy for me at the time. And so for a long time, like, I didn't have any way to actually play the game other than paying hourly and paying a monthly subscription after having paid the retail fee. So I was really into it. And then they started releasing these packs that gave you different costume pieces and powers and stuff. And so I spent a lot of money on those because, you know, that's where I was having fun. And then I did drift away from the game for a while, but I'd always kind of assumed it would be there, my characters would be there, and then, of course, what happens when a lot of people drift away from a game is the servers shut down, and now I don't have those City of Heroes characters. Some of them I have screenshots of, but, you know, that experience of getting to log on and run around with a pair of katanas and slice up bad guys, I don't have that anymore, and I don't have any way to show off other than whatever screenshots I happen to have taken and saved over the years. And so that experience has always stuck with me. Fortunately, with something like World of Warcraft, at this point, it's continued, you know, continuously since it came out, and I can still log on and experience my World of Warcraft characters, but one day that's probably just not going to be true. I mean, realistically, yeah, it'll end at some point. And so that's kind of hard. Once you've experienced that a few times, like losing that losing access to those assets that you've had and built up over time, you stop having as much trust in that system. And so that's kind of a bit of history for myself. My first exposure to crypto came actually with Stellar. So Stellar came out and they were giving out free Stellar to kind of seed the network to anyone who could prove that they were a person and had a Facebook account. And so I signed up for that, and I think they sent like $20 worth of Stellar. And I viewed it as this funny internet money. I'd read about Bitcoin. I'd read about Mt. Gox or Magic the Gathering Online Exchange, which, you know, and the collapse of that. And so Bitcoin had always been a curiosity to me, but it was hard to get into and kind of hard to take seriously from my perspective at the time. I didn't get it. But when Stellar was giving out free currency, you know, it's free, why not? And then I wanted to, like, is this thing for real? So what can I actually do with this Stellar? And I looked into it and I found out, well, I can turn it into Bitcoin. And then at the time I was actually playing Magic the Gathering Online. and there were bots that would sell you cards. And again, digital assets, completely centralized digital assets. But there were bots that would sell you cards if you would send them money. And one of the forms of money that they would accept was Bitcoin. And so I thought that was very cool. And so I set up an exchange account, converted my Stellar into Bitcoin, and actually spent half of it, so like $10 worth at the time. I've done the math, and I'm pretty sure that like the set of commons that I bought for $10 worth of Bitcoin, I think this was maybe 2014. I'm not sure exactly the year, actually. But it was basically, you know, hundreds of dollars worth of if I had held on to it. But that experience of having this digital currency, spending it, and getting this digital good in return was revelatory for me. Like, that was very cool. And so that stuck with me. So that years later, I'd been working as in e-commerce, doing website design and selling everything from supplements to plastic shoes that were like knockoffs of, can't even think of the name all of a sudden. Those
like Crocs or something.
Crocs, exactly. Knockoff Crocs. selling those online. And then also selling like equestrian gear. So I was working at one of these e-commerce companies doing design. And my boss at the time, who we talked about Bitcoin quite a lot. It was in the news and we were all curious about it. Again, we didn't own it, but we were watching it and like trying to talk ourselves into buying a bunch of Bitcoin just for pure speculative purposes. But then he's like, are you going to do the kitty thing? And I was like, I have no idea what you're talking about, but yes. and so that was Cryptokitties. So my boss actually exposed me to Cryptokitties in, must have been the very beginning of December. And I spent a couple of days getting set up with a MetaMask wallet and then trying to buy my first cat, but transactions failing, or I just didn't know what I was doing. The network was falling apart and melting. You try to buy a cat and it'd be sold out. And it was terrible. And so finally, I was just like, no, I'm going to buy a cat. I don't care. I don't know. I think I spent $40 on a cat called Cucumber. I had to go to like page 12 of the marketplace to try to find one that wasn't already sold. and so I started with this $40 cat. I felt kind of ridiculous because, like, how is this picture of a cat worth $40? Like, there's no way. But again, the money that I actually used was that original Stellar. So the half that I hadn't spent had appreciated. I'd bounced it between a couple of exchanges. So I converted it into Ethereum and spent it. So I figured, it was free money anyway. You know, like those Magic cards that I bought years ago, it's not like those are doing anything for me. I want to experience this. I want to know what this is all about. And so I bought my first cat. And then, of course, you have to buy a second one because you got to breed them, because that's what CryptoKitties are all about. And I just fell down the CryptoKitties rabbit hole and joined the Discord community. I'd always actually stayed off of Discord. I'd been kind of scared of it. For some reason, I thought it was only voice chat, and that just didn't seem like a good idea. I don't know. It wasn't something I could participate in passively. But, of course, I joined. I found out, no, it's actually text chat. And there's this awesome community of people in the CryptoKitties Discord. And essentially that was the NFT community back then, because CryptoKitties was the birth of the NFT standard. Of course, there were CryptoPunks and other things before, but most of the people in the CryptoKitties Discord were, well, they were the CryptoKitties community, and they basically were the NFT community. Some of those members spun off and created Axie Infinity later on. But everybody was really excited about everything that was happening, and it was infectious. And the people who were there were really, really smart. And I actually like to say that the early CryptoKitties community especially was just, like, full of, like, great people. And it is today, to be clear. But back then, in order to join the community, you basically had to be able to follow, like, this instruction manual to get started. You had to go through this whole long process. And so that kind of weeded out a lot of people. And so the people who were willing to go through that were the most enthusiastic and the most interested and, like, curious and technologically savvy. And it just created a really cool community to be a part of. And there were a lot of things happening then. I created a spreadsheet based off of speculation that people were sharing about how the kitty genes worked, because it was all kind of this black box for breeding cats. And that integrated me deeper into the community, got me into this idea of building tools for kitties. And then I actually reached out to another member of the community there, Poopy, also known as Jordan. And he was doing a great job of introducing new people into CryptoKitties. And I said, hey, do you want to create a tool that will let people find out if you breed two cats together, what are the offspring going to potentially look like? Like, what are the odds of that? Because I had the spreadsheet that did it, but spreadsheets are scary for a lot of people and not approachable. And so we actually turned that tool into a website using his, like, rating system for the cuteness of traits, a poop rating for each individual trait. So we built this website called Kittycalc, which became very popular in the community. Lots of people continue to use Kittycalc to this day. And it actually got us the attention of Axiom Zen. This was before they were Dapper Labs. And we talked to Mac Flavel, the chief creative officer, and then later Rohan, the CEO. And he flew myself and Jordan, well, the team flew us up to meet them in Vancouver and talk about CryptoKitties, talk about the community, talk about the process of building a tool. And at the time, I was also an artist for Kitty Hats, which let you, you know, buy accessories for your cats. So we talked about that as well. And I just wanted to be a part of everything because it was just so exciting and so interesting to me. And at that time, I really got it. Like, this is mine. And no matter what happens, I can always breed these cats together in the future. And, like, a server shutting down isn't going to be the end of CryptoKitties. Like, I'm exchanging my money for something of real, lasting, durable value. And it can't get hacked. Well, I mean, it can't get hacked on a server side. Obviously, like, my account could get hacked and things stolen. But that's just personal responsibility, I guess. So the whole thing started with, you know, game assets and digital assets and then crypto, and where it all clicked for me was CryptoKitties. Yeah, so the Dapper Labs team asked Jordan and I to join them and bring the perspective of this kind of super user of CryptoKitties onto the team, and I ended up taking over doing traits and fancy chases for CryptoKitties, which was kind of a dream come true because I'd always obviously been on the other side of that, curious how does this whole process work. So yeah, very, very long story, but that brought me to Dapper Labs, that brought me involved in creating NFTs, and from there I worked with the team to help design Cheese Wizards, which was the next project that we released. There were cool things that we were trying there. We wanted that gameplay to be entirely on-chain, and we tried very, very hard to make it work on Ethereum. But Ethereum just has a lot of limitations, both in solidity and then just, like, the network itself in terms of costs and times for approvals. But we thought it was important not to do this on some sidechain because we wanted composability and extensibility. We wanted the things that allowed kitty hats to exist, because that was something that, like, Dieter Shirley, again, the CTO of Dapper Labs, said blew his mind when that came out, because it was not something he ever imagined when they were working on CryptoKitties, this idea that someone would create this other token that can be owned by a cat. Like, it makes sense and it doesn't make sense, right?
Totally.
Yeah, but it wasn't something that had ever been conceived of, and it was only possible because of the blockchain, and because everything was on layer one. If you move things onto a layer two solution, now you can't build that unless they're building their composable thing on layer two, and that just breaks. And so we tried really hard to build on-chain gameplay with Cheese Wizards on Ethereum. Parts of it were really awesome, and then parts of it didn't go so great. We really learned a lot from that experience, and it was a very good experience for us. But it also kind of cemented the fact that this blockchain, while we love it, we love Ethereum, obviously. CryptoKitties started there. We all use it. We built a wallet, Dapper wallet, that uses that works on Ethereum, and we really wanted to build on Ethereum. It wasn't working so well for us. We had been working for a number of years on a new concept for a blockchain built around the idea that you could have everything existing on layer one together and be scalable and kind of work around the scalability trilemma by basically saying the parts that are really hard that you kind of need to centralize in some way in order to scale up. And that's often the solution that people come to, like when solving the trilemma is like, well, if we just centralize this more, we can use the data center, and a data center can process a lot of data. But then the problem is that you're relying on that data center and you're trusting that data center, and you can only have so many of those running realistically. But the insight that Deet and the team came up with is this idea that you can actually kind of split it into multiple functions. And what the data center does is actually objective, right? You can split it up so that they don't make any choices. They don't have any opportunities to dictate anything. And then it kind of doesn't matter if it's centralized, because all it is solving a math problem. And if a math problem can be objectively solved the same way every single time, then it really doesn't matter if that part is centralized, as long as everything around it has the right incentives. And that was a really hard problem for them to solve, but over the course of a couple of years, they did find solutions that they thought worked for it. And so given the choice between building out that system as a complete blockchain, which today we all know as Flow, and continuing to build on Ethereum, like Cheese Wizards kind of helped make that decision crystal clear that maybe one day Ethereum will get there, but what everyone's talking about is sharding. Sharding is going to really hurt composability. To build it something like Kitty Hats becomes exponentially more difficult for the developer to actually put together. And so it's just not going to happen as much. And so we really wanted everything to be on the same shard, on the same network, working together. And so that brought about Flow. And then simultaneous with all of that, we also have a great partnerships team who, because of the success of CryptoKitties, all of these consumer businesses have come to Dapper Labs. And they're like, you know, we're looking at this blockchain thing. We want to know, how does it let us interact with our customers in a new way? What opportunities does this open? You know, what doors does this open for us? And they've come to Dapper Labs because we're kind of a leader in the space because of the success of CryptoKitties, the mainstream attention that it got, you know, New York Times write-ups and so forth. And so we've had these great conversations with companies, and that's led to a number of really great relationships, including Warner Music Group, UFC, Ubisoft, and of course the NBA and the NBPA, the Players Association. And we struck a deal with them to create a collectibles experience and game in partnership with them. And that's where I've basically spent the past, I'm not sure, 8 months of my life, heavily focused primarily on working on NBA Topshot, basically ever since Cheese Wizards. And NBA Topshot, because of what we've learned and because of what we've been able to build, will be our launch product from a consumer point of view on Flow. And so it's been really exciting to see all of these pieces come together and finally have this system where we can create these assets that people can own that we're really, really hoping and expecting will scale with the number of users that, you know, the number of NBA fans that are out there. If you compare that, like the size of people who like to collect things about the NBA or play games featuring the NBA, to the entire NFT space today, like it dwarfs it immensely. And we just couldn't build that on Ethereum, so we're building that on Flow. And yeah, we're getting very close to actually launching Topshot soon. And I'm so excited to finally get to share it with everybody. So that's a very long answer, but that's where I come from.
you were perfectly placed, basically, considering your background to take on this role, because you have the kind of mind that can create spreadsheets, that can create new ways of interacting with these games, while at the same time having the creative ability to scope out new products. And it's really exciting to have sort of, I guess, found your position.
Absolutely. I tell everybody who'll listen that this job, and ever since I joined Dapper Labs, is my ikigai. It's like where I'm able to contribute to society in a way that society like appreciates, you know, financially and otherwise, like what I'm able to bring, and it's meaningful to me. It's what I love to do. It's something that fits in with my skill set, and I'm just, yeah, I'm really stoked to have this opportunity for sure.
So let's dig a little deeper into Topshot. It's a wonderful idea that I can own moments of brilliance from people within the NBA. That's the way I understand it. But perhaps give us the top line in terms of what is it that people are collecting, and sort of, you know, how the various bits fit together.
Yeah, that's a great way to describe what Topshot is. It is the opportunity to own the plays from the NBA, that those top highlights that you'll see on SportsCenter, other programs, or you might watch on YouTube. For the first time, you're going to have the opportunity to own those plays, which is itself a pretty abstract notion, but I think that blockchain creates this opportunity because, of course, those plays are best represented through multimedia and digital multimedia, right? I guess we could all trade VHS tapes or DVDs, but it makes a lot more sense for these to be these digital assets that you can watch on your phone, on your computer. And then the idea of owning the moments ties in with something that blockchain excels at, which is creating digital objects that have scarcity. And that's important because it means that, unlike a YouTube video where I can share a link and then we both have, you know, access to the YouTube video, you know, I mean, we all know what NFTs are, but applying that concept to a play and having it officially licensed with the NBA and NBPA, now you have these plays as NFTs, as these digital objects that you own. And one way that I like to think about it sometimes is, because I own it, you don't. And that extends to a certain level. So I'm getting pretty abstract to try to get more concrete. You can imagine LeBron James has an amazing dunk in a game, and we want to immortalize that and create a Top Shot collectible from that. So we would take that play, that video, and then we would gather up all of the stats from the game, the video from the play, the stats about the player, and we package it all up into this really cool 3D collectible that we call a moment. And it's an NFT, and it can be available in these multiple sets or multiple editions. And so there's a scarce edition. We have this special edition called Hollow 2020. And if you own that LeBron James dunk in the Hollow 2020 edition, that means that you're only one of 50 people in the world who can ever own that edition of the play. And then we also have these editions, the base set editions. Those are much more common and available to people. They're still digital assets that you own, but rather than being number capped to 50, like the Hollow 2020 edition, those are time capped. They're going to be available for a period of time, and then after that, we're going to stop making them. And so however many people own at that point, or how many will ever exist. So if you want to go get one, you'll have to get it from somebody else who owns it. And so your collection of plays, and then the quality of those plays that you own, is really going to say a lot about you as a fan. It's going to say, like, this is what I value, this is what I want to collect, this is what I want to show off to people. I want to be the person, I want to be one of those 50 people in the world who own, you know, the Hollow 2020, the really the legendary version of this play and be able to show that off to people and get credit for that. And so there's this whole collector fandom aspect to being able to own these plays. And it's something that has never existed before. You have stuff like baseball cards where you're, you know, owning a representation of the player. But this is actually going into an individual, like, super cool highlight that happened in the NBA.
So Flo has, instead of just collecting these moments, you actually have a gaming aspect to Top Shot as well. Could you talk us through how that works?
Absolutely, yeah. And so one reason that I focus on the collectible aspect when talking about it is I'm also a collector myself. I have piles of Magic cards. I have Hero Clicks. I have all kinds of collectibles in my house. I have well over 1,000 Cryptokitties. Digital collectibles are great because, you know, I don't have to find a place to store them and they don't gather dust. And they're kept in perfect condition all the time. And so I really connect with the collectible side of it. But you're right that these go a step further because we're also building a mobile game that uses these NFTs as assets to kind of power up your players. And if you own that legendary Holo 2020 edition of the LeBron dunk, then you're going to actually be able to use that, give it to one of your players, basically inspire one of your players with it, and allow them to become better at dunking themselves in the game. And so the game itself is competitive and allows you to basically play basketball against other people, but you're going to get to be sort of the GM, build up a team, and then power up and level up your players on the team to get better and better and to be able to perform better in the game. And so the NFTs play a huge role in that. Now, what's really interesting about the game is we're planning to release it on the mobile stores as sort of a traditional free-to-play gaming experience where you can come in and you can actually earn in-game versions of, say, that LeBron dunk, and you can use that to give some, you know, extra dunking power to your player. But along the way, when you want to upgrade your player, you're actually going to need to consume that in-game asset that you've received, and it'll be gone. So it'll like kind of fuse into the player and allow the player to level up, but you won't have that asset anymore. Mm. But what's unique to what we're doing is if you own the NFT version of that, or if you want to go buy the NFT version of that, link your account, now you can actually apply that NFT version. And when you upgrade your player, it isn't consumed, right? Because NFTs are durable. And so you have a lot of extra value if you have the choice of just getting these things in the free-to-play game, which, as we all know, really means often spending quite a lot of money on assets that you don't own. Or you can go to the marketplace and you can buy these or trade them with other people and actually own the asset, and it continues to be yours. It's collectible outside of the gaming experience, but it also is used within the gaming experience in a way where it's better for you than the fake version, kind of, if you want to put it that way, right? The normal digital game asset that only exists on a centralized server, those are consumable within the game. So we'll still have that concept of gathering, collecting plays, but if you don't own it, then they get consumed. And essentially, we're looking at this as a great way for people to be like, well, why do I want to own this thing that's just going to get eaten up, you know, that also costs me real money essentially to buy, when I can own the real thing and that has meaning. And we're sort of going to Trojan horse some players of the game into the NFT space because, yes, like the value proposition is there, and we're just going to expose it to people, you know.
That's great, because you're bringing the gamers and then you're bringing the collectors together, and
absolutely,
and giving them both the incentives on the same things, basically.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, the better your collection, the better you're going to be in the gameplay, and then when you want to level up your gameplay, you're probably going to want to go improve your collection, and so it really creates this nice go between from those two connected worlds.
It's like opening up a new rabbit hole for them all to fall down and come join us down here in the NFT space.
Yeah, so our goal at Dapper Labs is to bring mainstream adoption of blockchain to people. And one great way to do that is just basically introduce what they're already familiar with, these digital assets, you know, that you collect these things, and saying, by the way, there's a better version of this, and just giving them every opportunity to find their way into the better version. And then I think exactly they'll fall down the rabbit hole and they'll see like that wide world, and they'll become blockchain users. They might not even realize that they're blockchain users, right? They might just see like, oh, I just own the better version of this thing. And that's exactly right.
I remember when I was young, I used to collect cards of every type of description, and I remember opening these packets, and you could almost, the first thing you did was fan them out, and if you had two shinies instead of one, you had this moment of like sheer delight, right? Because like you'd won the game, right? You'd bought this thing for the same price as any of those other packets, but you've got an extra shiny, and there it is. I think they call it surprise and delight. Is that sense? Yeah. Can you describe how you've brought that, or if you can bring that element to a blockchain-based version of that, considering there are ways of looking behind the scenes, there's certain transparencies that come with blockchain. It would be really interesting to just have a quick dive into how you try and bring that experience to Topshot.
Yeah, so we are looking still at ways of doing on-chain packs, maybe on-chain cases, where we're able to give you a pack that you can then choose not to open, hold on to, maybe sell to or give to a friend. And the contents of that pack will remain the same, but secret. Because obviously, if you can look inside the pack, and that's the big trick, right? Is how do you do that in a way where we're not like, where the pack is a real thing that contains real NFTs, but you don't know what's inside of it? That's something that we're working to solve still. And so what we're going to do is actually, at launch, we are going to sell packs of these moments. But there's a couple of... One, you're going to open the pack as soon as you receive it. And that's one way that we're going to get around this idea. Like, you might be able to see the whole pool of moments that are available in packs. But you won't be able to take a slice of that pool and hold on to it in secret, at least at launch. And so you can buy a pack, and then you're gonna have that experience. And we've built this cool pack opening experience that really celebrates when you get one of those like legendary tier moments. But as part of that, we're selling the packs actually with sort of more guaranteed contents, in that you won't have the opportunity to buy a pack and get two shinies when most of the time you only get one. So at launch, when we sell you a pack that we say contains a legendary, you'll know it contains a legendary. Now, I still think that there's a good amount of this surprise and delight, because myself personally, I'm a big Lakers fan. I grew up in Southern California in the 90s, and I was a fan before the Shaq and Kobe era. But then, of course, when they were wrecking the court, you know, that was amazing. And so I continue to be a Lakers fan to this day. And when I'm opening a pack, when I get to that legendary moment and I reveal what that is, I'm always hoping for a Laker, like realistically. I have other favorite players. I'm kind of a surrogate fan of the Raptors. Thanks, Dapper Labs is up in Canada. I work remotely from the States, but I feel that kinship and connection to the Canadian team now. And so, like, I'll be happy if I open a Raptor. Although, if I open a member of the Celtics, you know, I'll probably be heading to the secondary market to offload that as quickly as possible. I'm not a fan of Boston sports. it's a regional thing, I think. But so you'll still have sort of that surprise and delight of what moment you're getting when you open the pack. But you won't, for now, be able to hold on to the packs. You'll have to... You'll open it as soon as you receive those packs. But that is absolutely something that we're looking into. And one fun thing that I love to do is watch these YouTube videos of people pulling up these like old Topps wax packs from like, I don't know, the 60s. And they've been preserved all this time. And they get out their white gloves and the special mat and they carefully peel them open and like pull out the gum stick, which is like brittle and old and go one by one through the cards. And I think it'll be awesome if we can recreate that and actually have some of these packs that people can hold on to. And maybe, you know, 60 years from now, someone opens a Topshot pack from year one and they're hoping, like, I hope there's a Zion Williamson inside of this, you know? I think that'll be an amazing thing, and we definitely want to be able to deliver that experience.
So I've spent this week binge watching The Last Dance on Netflix.
Oh, yes.
And yeah, it's got me totally fired up about that era, because for those sort of 6 years, I was really into basketball at school and was a huge Shaq and Penny Hardaway fan when they were Orlando Magic. And I understand it at the moment, you've got the current basketball layout, but you don't have the previous players that have left the league now. I suppose my question is, what's it going to take to get Michael Jordan on board?
Yeah, that's a great question. And so for context, yeah, our initial launch moments are going to be highlights from this current season. Say current season, the season might be over, nobody knows at this point, thanks to everything that's going on in the world. But from the games that have been played this season, we're going to have plays from every team, of course, represented. But they will all be plays from this year at the launch of the product. And part of that is we have a deal with the Players Association for the NBA, and they have deals with their individual players. And we're able to release moments from previous seasons, and we will. Over time, we'll have special releases. But in order to release a moment that features an MJ, we do have to create a special, like, we have to sign MJ specifically through his people, right? and absolutely, like, this product, you know, we want MJ, of course. and so the best way for us to get there is actually if we release this, and if we can grow this into a cultural phenomenon, you know, we'll have MJ and everyone else like knocking on our door. Hey, how do I get myself in Topshot? I'm not saying that we're banking on that in order to get MJ on board. We're going to absolutely talk to him. But what we want to do is be able to come to him and say, look at this. There's you know, whatever, a million people who collect these moments, and they're all asking for MJ. So then at that point, you know, we'll talk to him and it'll hopefully be inevitable from his point of view that he will sign a deal with us and we'll be able to release moments featuring MJ. And that goes for a number of other high profile players from the past as well. But I absolutely see this as a situation where we can sign those deals. And I think that they're going to demand to be a part of it. Maybe that's me being a little optimistic, but I'm very excited about what we've created, and I think that it's just this really great thing that's going to be so different from what people have seen, and yet familiar in all the right ways. And if you look at, like, recently Garbage Pail Kids just released on the Topps Wax blockchain, and they sold out of, I think it's $100,000 worth of these cards within 28 hours.
Oh, they sold out already, have they?
Oh yeah, and the secondary market is going kind of crazy from what I hear. Cards are selling for hundreds of dollars worth of wax in some cases already, and these were cards that were bought in $5 and $25 packs. Mm. And so I see that this is really a great time where people are ready for digital collectibles, and Topshot, by far the coolest and best that I've ever seen. It's like, yeah, it's just amazing, and so I really do see that this is something that will have so many people collecting and so many people wanting to be a part of it. My dream is that after a game, a player is going to get interviewed, and their response they're going to respond to a question like about, you know, tell us about that dunk that you had that won the game in the fourth quarter or whatever. And they're going to be saying, you know, I was just in the zone. It was really great. And I can't wait to own the Topshot of that moment.
yeah.
And so I can see one day that may be happening. But certainly at that point, you know, MJ's gonna need to be a part of it, and that is our hopes and dreams.
I think you're ready that the world is ready for digital collectibles, especially now that you know, it's so much more sanitary to exchange digital.
Absolutely.
When it comes to the massive audience that the NBA has worldwide, are we going to be seeing, you know, in-game adverts for Topshot? Is that sort of thing, like television advertising? Will it be that integrated with like the official games?
Yeah, so we're still working on some of our marketing plans for when the season returns, whenever that is, or when next season begins. But one huge advantage of working directly with the NBA is they're able to reach out to all of those fans. You know, they have relationships with them, and they're going to be promoting Topshot, of course, to those fans in all kinds of mediums. And at the same time, we're going to be working with bloggers, fan communities. And there's massive fan communities. You know, if you look at like Golden State Warriors SB Nation site, you know, that's probably larger than the whole NFT space today, for example. And we're going to be working with these communities, and we're going to be working with athletes as well, who get the technology, or who just like get beyond the technology to this concept of owning these digital plays, who want to be a part of that, and who will be talking about that. So when it comes to what will happen during the season, we'll see, and we're still working on those plans, but we definitely see so many avenues for reaching out to all of those. I think there's over a billion NBA fans, you know, and getting them all excited about and trying out and experiencing Top Shot for themselves. With a lot of ways to reach them.
The way I understand it, there is various tiers of collectibles in differing scarcity. You have this base set, and then you have some that eventually become sort of available via auction. When it becomes, you know, incredibly rare. I guess one of the things I was trying to understand is, are there plays that only exist in certain of those tranches, or do the plays exist throughout? It's just how the plays are wrapped that designates scarcity.
Yeah, so it's a little bit of both. For the majority of plays, they'll be available in multiple tiers. And I had brought up the legendary tier before. We also have the base set tier, which is our common tier. We also have a rare tier, which is obviously between the common and the legendary. And then you alluded to this sort of top tier. We call it the ultimate tier. And those are scarce, like one of three, right? There'll only be three versions of this play in that edition ever. And those ones we would be selling via auction. For the most part, plays will be released in multiple sets across multiple tiers. So that LeBron dunk that you watched on TV, the next day we make it available. We don't think that it would be best to only make that available to three people in the world, because obviously LeBron has a lot of fans all over the place. But at the same time, we don't want it to just be something that everyone can like pick up off the street. And so there's a balance that we need to strike, and there's multiple audiences out there. There's going to be people who just want to complete a collection of LeBron plays, and we want to make sure that that's accessible and available to them. And then there's people who are going to be like, no, I'm the world's biggest LeBron fan, and I want people to know I'm better than all those other LeBron fans. And so I'm going to go out of my way and make a point of bidding on these one of threes, of owning these Hollow 2020 editions of those plays. And so if you look at my collection, it's going to be shiny, and it's going to be clearly special and differentiated from other people. And again, because of the guaranteed scarcity on the blockchain, I'm going to be able to say, I'm one of three people who could ever own a collection as awesome as this. And so that's one way that we differentiate between those tiers. Now, as for whether there will be plays that aren't available in that common tier, I believe that that will be the case for certain plays in certain situations. So generally, plays will be available in multiple tiers. and then it'll be up to you how you want to collect them. And also, like, what kind of power level are you looking for in the game in some cases? But there will be some plays that we release that will only be available in particular tiers. And so those plays will just be scarce. They will be things that most people won't be able to have. But for the most part, we do want everyone to be able to build up a version of a collection that they want to own. And that just means that while there will be scarcity, and especially this time-based scarcity, right? If you want to build up a collection of every LeBron play, but you don't find out about Top Shot for a year for some reason, then you're going to have to go to the secondary marketplace to find most of those plays. And at that time, you know, there might be 3, 5, 10 or more times as many players, collectors in the space, and it might be really hard to get a hold of some of those early ones. And so you might only be able to collect all LeBron moments from the moment you started going forward, but at least at that point you'll have that option. And we want to make sure that people do have that option to build up their personal collections in that way.
Did you ever imagine that someone could come the opposite way, in the sense that I'm a total NFT head and I love blockchain and I'm firmly down the rabbit hole. I know nothing about the NBA. And I feel like I'm coming the other direction. I'm going to fall down the NBA rabbit hole via this game. And I'm actually going to have to find out about these amazing players and what makes a good dunk and what isn't, and so on and so forth. So congratulations. You've definitely made at least one of us go the opposite direction.
Absolutely, and that's fantastic, and I'm sure the NBA will love to hear it as well. We definitely have a lot of, you know, we have a community of collectors from CryptoKitties and Cheese Wizards and even Dapper Wallet, and we do know that not everybody is already an NBA fan, but these are going to be so these are going to be the first real digital collectibles on Flow. They're going to be this massively mainstream thing. I personally, I'm not a big fan of the Garbage Pail Kids, but, you know, of course I bought a couple of packs on Wax. And I don't know how I feel about the Wax blockchain, but we don't have to go there. but I did buy a couple of packs. And so, yeah, absolutely. I think that this is going to be a great opportunity for you to become a fan. There's a lot of players that I didn't know anything about, but through the process of building Top Shot, like, I just really love them, like Luca, and just, you know, I get excited now when I'm testing and I open a pack and I get a Luca play. I'm like, oh yay! And that wasn't a connection I had before. So absolutely, there's that opportunity, and we welcome you wholeheartedly into the fold. And I think that you will fall very, very deeply into the rabbit hole, because when you see just the awesomeness of these plays, it's like, wow, that is impressive, and I want more.
Cool.
I was thinking a potential way to differentiate would be having different camera angles for different tiers. It'd be quite clear. Like the prime, the best camera angle being only available with the ultimate editions or something like that would be quite fun.
Absolutely. That's something we definitely want to explore. For our initial launch, that won't be a part of the way things are, but every moment that we release is going to be part of a series. And I see a huge opportunity as we roll into the next NBA season and start Series 2 of the Top Shot collectibles to really make a lot of improvements. And we'll have gotten a lot of feedback from users and collectors. And then we'll be able to go talk to the NBA and say, people really want, you know, these multiple camera angles, and they want to differentiate their collectibles at those scarce tiers. What can we do? And I think that there are opportunities to really set those apart. And so I see Series 2 and future series as real opportunities to implement a lot of that. And so I encourage everybody, we love listening to feedback. I encourage everybody to join our Discord and talk to everybody there. Send us emails, and we want to hear all that feedback. And we're going to look to incorporate as much of it as possible.
So, getting onto more of the NFT kind of side of things, obviously these are all video files. They're enormous. They can't be stored on chain. What is your mechanism for storing them and sort of ensuring their longevity, as it were?
Yeah, so Flow is a computational blockchain, right? It's all about shared state, and state includes things like ownership. but state doesn't really include things like a massive video file. And so it doesn't necessarily make sense for those video files to be stored on the Flow blockchain. But obviously, when you get a digital collectible, you want to know that it's durable. You want to know that you're going to continue to be able to access that. And so that's something that we're still looking into solutions for storage of the media files in a way that is decentralized and durable. And I think that that's really important. As for the tokens themselves, they do contain a lot of metadata, and that's really important because that metadata being stored on chain means that, well, for one thing, it means that you own what you think you own. The actual token, if you look at it on chain, it does say, you know, this is a LeBron James dunk from this state and so forth. And you can see very clearly this is one of 50 Holo 2020 editions of this play that exist. And all of that will be completely on chain, of course. But the more metadata that we include on chain, that allows more composability and extensibility. So we're releasing a game that uses these moments. But because of blockchain, there's really nothing stopping somebody else from creating a game that looks at the metadata that's on these moments. And if you're able to look at the play and see this was from a game where the Golden State Warriors won by 20 points, you could build a game where that matters. And so having that metadata on chain becomes extra important because it allows for that kind of composability and extensibility. And so we'll be storing that. And because Flow is so much more scalable than Ethereum, that means that we can include a lot more of that metadata in the asset, in the NFT itself. And that just opens up so many more avenues for that kind of extensibility.
How long do I have to save up for the packs?
Yeah, so I would say start saving already. We're getting very close to release, and we are planning to release a closed beta before we open the gates for everybody. And anyone who's interested in being a part of that closed beta, I think you should go to the NBA Top Shot website. And make sure that you've signed up, put in your email address so that we can let you know and get you on the wait list already ahead of those who are going to find out about it after a period of time. But we're getting pretty close to being able to open that closed beta and let people in and let people start to experience. One thing that I will say is that we're releasing stages. So we're going to start off by releasing the collectible experience, which is the ability to buy packs and actually collect these moments. And then shortly after, we'll actually release a peer-to-peer marketplace that allow you to buy and sell the moments between users. Similar to with CryptoKitties, we had our own native marketplace. There was no OpenSea at the time. And likewise, at launch, there's not going to be any generic marketplace on the Flow ecosystem. So we're building and we'll be releasing a marketplace for Topshot that's native to the website and native to the experience. And then we're looking to release the actual mobile game down the road as the next season comes. But we'll be testing it along the way. And so we'll see how that goes. That's still very much actively in development, but it will be a staged release where the actual gameplay part comes later down the road. Though I do see these collectibles as, like, personally, I'm excited just to open packs and own these moments, but I am looking forward to when the game does eventually come.
You mentioned earlier about the sharding in Ethereum 2.0 mm-hmm. and it not working well with NFTs in terms of composability. And you probably have a lot more insight into this because we don't really know what the deal is there. But when Ethereum moves into that sort of state, what does that mean for NFTs in general? I mean, does that mean that it's not actually going to bring scalability?
Yeah, so, I mean, it'll bring scalability in the way that most people talk about it, which is transactions per second, right? The need for transaction fees and all of those things will presumably become less expensive, and you'll be able to, you know, if a million people want to perform transactions, I don't know if they're going to scale to that level, but we'll find out. But but more people will be able to perform transactions at the same time and trade their NFTs. But there's going to be a whole lot of complexity driving a lot of those things. And a lot of that complexity, as I understand it, and I'm not extremely technical, I'm not a developer, and so I kind of have just a general understanding, things I've picked up through osmosis. So don't take my word as particularly, you know, knowledgeable, really. But there's going to be a lot of complexities added to the developer side of things if you want to interact across smart contracts. And so I imagine that certain tools like Uniswap and probably OpenSea will build in support that's necessary to handle moving an NFT across shards, right? If the buyer's on one shard and the seller's on another shard, or the smart contract's on one shard. Again, I don't know exactly the details, but there's going to be a lot of complexities involved there. And I think that I would expect that the main players are going to handle those complexities, release smart contracts that can deal with all of them. But if I wanted to release Kitty Hats again today, I believe that's going to become exponentially more complex to try to write that code, or possibly I'll have to try to make sure that I release my contract on the same shard that has CryptoKitties, but then that might limit me from allowing these same assets to be Axie Hats, right? If Axie is on another shard, just as an example. And so there's just all these questions of and complexities that arise that really limit what are the very natural ways of interacting between these assets when they all exist together. And again, that's my very non-technical understanding of the situation.
Thank you. Thank you so much for all your thoughts and time today. I really feel like I've got a better handle on what Topshot is and what it could do for the space, really, in many ways. So yeah, once again, thank you so much for your time. In terms of people out there that want to interact, obviously they, as you've mentioned, you can get to the website. What else is there that people can do now? Get onto Twitter, follow you. Like how best can people interact?
Definitely. So there's so if you want to follow me on Twitter, I'm at Alan Falcon, ALANFALCON on Twitter, and I'm obviously going to be tweeting about Top Shot quite a lot as we release. And I'll also be tweeting about all the other stuff we're working on, like CryptoKitties. We announced our artist series. There's some really cool stuff happening there. We'll be actually later today, as we record this, we'll be selling our first Momo Wang artist series kitties on Nifty Gateway, and I'm really excited to see.
Yeah, that's hugely exciting
to see that. And yeah, I'm hoping I'll be able to get in there. I'm kind of expecting I won't, but I'm gonna try to pick one of those up for myself. But I'll be tweeting about all of those things that come out, and of course everything about Top Shot. But I think the biggest thing is just make sure that you go to the NBATopshot.com website. Make sure that you get your name on the exclusive early access wait list there, and then just watch your email, and we'll make sure that we get you in there. And then on that website, we also have links to our Top Shot Twitter, Instagram, and Discord. And then Discord is a great way to interact with us, ask questions, meet other fans, and I highly recommend that. We've already got a budding community there, even though there's no product released yet. And if the CryptoKitties and the other NFT communities that we're a part of, including, you know, the non-fungible community, are any indication, then it's going to be a really fun community to be a part of. So I definitely invite you to join us on the Top Shot Discord.
Before you go, Alan, I understand that you're missing a gerbil.
I am. Yeah. So I don't know. It slipped my mind, or somehow I managed to not enter one of the bio contests on Twitter. And so there's one gerbil that I don't own, and it's been driving me a little bit crazy. I actually, I actually went and made offers on all of the gerbil that exists out there to all of the owners on OpenSea that I thought was a pretty fair offer. You know, they got theirs for free, right? So they're getting some free money. Nobody responded. Nobody is willing to part with these things. And I totally get it, right? If somebody made an offer on one of my gerbils, no, of course not. They're mine. And so it's really interesting. But yeah, there's just one that I haven't been able to get my hands on, and I continue to kick myself.
I think it's huddle gerbil, and I think, unfortunately, it is the scarcest gerbil.
Yes, yes.
There's only nine.
And of course, it would be the gerbil that tells all of the owners, you know, don't sell me, right?
I'm sure there's probably a legendary dunk out there somewhere. That might tear my hodl gerbil away from me. Who knows? Maybe we can work something out.
If anyone's listening and they want to sell their hodl gerbil, yes. Contact Alan.
Yes, contact Alan. Great stuff.
Great. Well, thanks very much. It's been a pleasure.
Yes, thank you so much for having me. It was great to get to talk to you and meet you. I've been a huge fan of the show from the beginning, as you know, and looking forward to hearing everything that comes next.
Okay, so on to gerbils. We have Prepper Gerbil this week. We've had lots of great entries. And we have a guest, Alan. Thank you for staying on and joining us to read out some gerbil entries.
Absolutely. This is really exciting for me.
This was our original vision, actually, when we started the podcast. We were sort of thinking, yeah, we'll just get the guests to stay on and we could all read out gerbil entries and have a laugh. But actually, in practice, it wasn't always... It didn't seem natural, but today it seems natural. So, yeah, let's go for it. Do you have a specific one you want to go for first?
Yeah, so there's a few that I was hoping to be able to read out. The awesome. First one is from Where Kitty.
Yes.
Okay, so here we go. Prepper Gerbil had known it all along that a disaster was bound to happen sooner or later, and now the day was finally here. He looked back to his deep tunnels, filled up with all kind of useful stuff over several years. Then he sealed off the entrance and sat down happily in his chamber with a large chunk of aged cheese. No more would anyone laugh at him because his grandmother was a hamster.
I love it. Again, from one of our most dedicated creatives, yes, Where Kitty has been with us the whole way through, just like you.
I think more. I think she also managed to avoid missing hodl gerbil. So she's better off than I am.
Next up, what's another one that's taken your fancy?
All right. So Third Man Design had this entry. Prepper Gerbil didn't know if her grandma had digital assets in mind when she said, "Always buy extra in troubled times." For sure, generative space travelers, CryptoPunks, and listed edition art wasn't quite the same as stocking up on tinned peaches in the Great Nut Famine of 03, but she felt it was a good maxim to live by and wasn't willing to risk letting Grandma down. As her eye was drawn to the one-of-one label on screen, she whispered, "This one's for you, Grandmama."
Oh man,
oh, that's just great.
We're not going to be able to read. We're going to have to get Alan on every time, dude. There's a lot of power in the delivery here. Much better than my monotone reading.
No, not at all. Not at all. I like the common grandmother theme here.
Shall I do anonymous nobody? Prepper Gerbil was just like any other gerbil before the virus entered his reality through the TV set. He has since bartered it away for a pallet of toilet paper and 21 cases of water, bartered away his Ford Fiat for a .50 caliber Desert Eagle and a bottle of hand sanitizer.
Wow.
Those hand sanitizers are hard to come by, aren't they?
they certainly are. Thank you, Anonymous Nobody. Luke, have a crack at one.
Well, in an unprecedented turn of events, I'm going to be reading out Alan Falcon in front of Alan Falcon. So
better get it right.
We'll see. Prepper Gerbil hasn't seen the sun. Ever. They have not smelled fresh air. They also have not worked a day in their life. Never lacked for toilet paper, nor for canned cheeseburgers. Their great times six grand gerbil prepped for this 21 years ago, and now they are set for generations.
It's quite
I feel
a,
like
quite
that great grand gerbil right now, actually.
are canned cheeseburgers a thing?
I have no idea.
They sound amazing.
I just wanted something a little bit random in there.
I think they are a thing, aren't they?
I can't.
Wasn't it in Futurama or something?
I don't know. They sound amazing. Cool. Okay. Shall I do Mr. Logic beer? In brackets, Lander.
Yeah.
Smoking meth. Sorry. Sorry, I wasn't expecting that. Oh, wow. Okay, that's quite a thing to start with. Okay, here we go. Smoking meth in his mama's trailer while sharing conspiracy theories on Facebook with a few people that haven't blocked or unfollowed him yet, and frantically looking out of the window for the NSA agents that have been spying on him for years. Okay, there we go. That's a snapshot in the life of his prepper gerbil.
Thank you, Landa.
Thank you. Yes, indeed. Thanks.
I thought that there was a kind of poetry to the Flaz's entry. So
let's go with that then.
All right. Okay. Dusk and the crickets chirped. Prepper Gerbil's features hard to read under the peak of his MAGA hat, but if anything, display the smugness that comes with being proven right. He was ready. His children had finished their daily crossbow training and his AR-15 cleaned and oiled. Sat in the old rocking chair, the screen door flapped, and he glanced at the tattoo, his mantra. A well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of the free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. No, sir, it won't, he whispered.
Brilliantly read, thank
that
you.
That prepper gerbil is ready for Armageddon. Ready for Skynet.
So the winner is everyone. Everyone wins. Wow. This week. We decided to do this slightly differently because they all go down the same lines, pretty much. I mean, apart from the meth, but
yeah.
So we've taken an aspect from every gerbil here and put them all into one, and so it's a joint authorship this week.
That's awesome.
I wish we could show you it right now, but it's not going to be ready until Sunday.
So, well, I can't wait until my podcatcher updates and I get to see Prepper Gerbil for the first time.
Well, surprise and delight. You can always expect it from the non-fun gerbils.
Absolutely.
Well, once again, thank you so much for taking the time out. It's been great fun. And good luck with the rollout of this incredibly important project for the space.
Thank you so much, and we'll see you there, and we'll make basketball fans out of you.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah.